So we made suggestions here for consideration for, you know, some welfare schemes in other places globally. We know, like countries like India, where they've come up with suggestions for guaranteeing employment, even if for a few months every year. If you find an unemployed person and you say, every year you can come and work for a salary for 3 months, that would be a good start. It probably gives them something to look forward to, but also gives them the necessary skills and the attitude they require to move on in life. So it's one of the issues that we identified in the paper. I don't have much time to go into any greater detail, but what I also want to say is that the paper and the report itself will be available on the DWPI website. But I think one of the things that we made from the round table we had a few minutes ago is the fact that a lot of progress has been achieved. Our figures are quite alarming, but I think we need also to understand that it's the first time we are getting a feel for poverty since 2003. And as I said earlier on, you have to understand that when I say 4 out of every 5 people are living below the total poverty reduction line, it's probably an improvement from what the situation might have been in 2008 if we'd done that survey. So a lot of work for Honourable Minister needs to do. I thank you all for listening.
The Honourable Minister Tendai Biti to make a presentation to us on the emerging lessons in Zimbabwe after 4 years of inclusive development. Could you?
Once again invited us to this great institute. I know that there are many Zimbabweans in the room who probably, if I were to ask them what they would want to hear about elections, when we are going to have them in the referendum. So I'll try to cover a lot of things in a very short period of time. I've actually prepared 2 papers for this topic, because I keep on getting different topics from David and so I've got three papers, but I'll try to speak to many issues, but try to anticipate many of the questions that I know in the midst of many of you. I also must say that it has been a very refreshing 2 days. In fact, I actually never thought I would practice law. My ambition was actually to get a staff development and then teach law, but fate had a plan for me. So I love university settings. So the past 2 days in which I've spent here, interrogating Zimbabwe economy, interrogating failed states, extractive institutions, it's been a very refreshing period for me, and I wish that I could do that more. Many people ask me, what are you going to do after next year's election? I really miss the law, to be honest, preparing heads of argument and appearing in court. But I think an academic setting would also be quite attractive. I want to talk about, I think the discussions which we've been having the last 2 days have been discussions centered on rethinking the state's development in economics, not just for Zimbabwe, but for the rest of Africa. I think the rest of Africa and many other dominated social formations within Southeast Asia, within Latin America, the areas where poverty, underdevelopment, inclusivity, and bad politics, dictatorships, coups, and then the order of the day. And I think the new discourse in town is how do we get out of this malaise, how do we get out of this quagmire. And Zimbabwe, together with countries like perhaps Cote d'Ivoire, perhaps Sudan, the two Sudans, perhaps Somalia, the Democratic Republic of Congo, offer a good experimental ground of examining and unpacking and saying what is the way forward. In yesterday's meeting, I spoke of states that I consider to be in permanent crisis, states in permanent crisis. And by that, I make reference to those states which have temporal periods, which have permanent periods of conflict, which are interrupted by temporal periods of peace. It's constant violence, constant conflict, constant depreciation, which is interrupted by peace. Zimbabwe is a very good example of a country like that. And yesterday I gave a historical account of our country's development since the 1890s, where you have actually never had more than 10 years, 15 years of uninterrupted peace. The graph there, you just brought it up, I didn't want to talk about it. But that graph there is from 1960. And you see the violent dislocation that has been taking place. The scale of that graph is actually false. If I were to do that graph in a proper circle, you will actually see that while many countries have periods of booms and slums, and they move in circles of V or VW, the slump of Zimbabwe, and of these states that I call states in a permanent crisis, they are almost in periods of permanent use or of permanent use, so sustained periods of depression, and then once in a while you bubble up and you float above the surface. If I show you the graph for the lost ticket, actually we can go to the graph of the lost ticket. Look at that graph. That graph there shows Zimbabwe's economic performance. Now that figure there is under zero. In other words, we're operating in a minus zero situation. But look at the persistence and the consistency of the depression. And the unique thing about Zimbabwe's economy is this proneness to depression. Is this seductive proneness to depression at an economic level. But if you also superimpose what would be happening politically each time we are in that we are in a U, but that U is consistent, it's almost like an M. If you superimpose that with the political development, you either see civil war, civil crisis, political adjustments, and massive dislocation of the population. If I were to give you the same graphs for Rwanda, the same graphs for the Democratic Republic of Congo, the same graphs for the Sudan, the same graphs for Somalia, to some extent the Central African Republic, you'll actually be shocked by the extent of the cyclicality that arrests Zimbabwe and that arrests these countries, which is why I've been referring to them to states that are in permanent, crisis. And I think the crisis years 1997 to 2008 is possibly the apex there we saw 60% devaluation of the economy. We saw for the first time a country that was not involved in a war experiencing negative declines in GDP of more than 10 years. That has never happened in a country that is not involved in war, that has experienced negative declines in GDP for more than 10 years, from modest declines of minus 2.7 in 1997 to minus 14% in 2000 in 2008. And in fact, when you get to declines of minus 14%, figures and economics actually mean nothing. You know, if you have month-on-month inflation of 2 million percent, if you've got broad money supply M3, that is 3,000% of GDP, economics actually means nothing. If you've got inflation of 231 million percent, July of 2008, hyperinflation actually means nothing. I think I said when I came here in 2009 that hyperinflation is the economic environment which describes the country with month-on-month inflation of more than 80%. But if you've got daily inflation of more than 1 million percent, you economists must find new lexicon for hyperinflation. The word hyperinflation can't describe the situation. But I think the most worrying thing, I mean, we can talk about hyperinflation, we can talk about the devaluation of the economy, we can talk about the low productive levels of 2 to 10% capacity utilization. I think the biggest suffering and the biggest crisis figures for me are the depreciation of the quality of life of Zimbabweans, the human development indices, whether it's maternal mortality rates, infant mortality rates, the levels of our life expectation, which is sunk to as low as 34 for women and 37 for men. In fact, official figures that were released in 2008 by the Ministry of Health show that Zimbabweans were dying at the rate of 4,000 per week. That gives you 160,000 people in 10 months, more than the 50,000 or so that died in the 25 years of our national liberation. So Black Zimbabwe in 1 year in 10 months was killing more people than the white men had killed. Sorry, that the white men and the black men had killed during 25 years of liberation, which is a serious indictment. And so for me, I think, if I might answer the first question, what are the lessons of the last 4 years? What we tried to do in the last 4 years is that it was self-evident that Zimbabwe was a disastrous, the balance sheet was in deficit. So we actually had to rebuild and reconstruct this state. And I said to a meeting this morning that one of the first things that happened when I got into the Ministry of Finance on a chilly Monday morning, the 16th of February 2009, was that I walked into this similarly lit office, and as soon as I entered my office, in fact, as soon as I entered my office, this fat gentleman entered into my office. I don't know why he was fat. Everyone was losing weight. So they said, Minister, tomorrow, after the formalities, they said to me, Minister, tomorrow is government payday. Oh, so payday, yes. How much are we? How much do we have in the bank account? A minister, we've got $4 million. How much do we have to pay? We have to pay $30 million. So what are we going to do about the $26 million per minister? We're waiting for you. At that very moment, I actually realized that we have to have a plan. So at that very same moment, we started drafting the short-term emergency recovery program. And the short-term emergency recovery program was centered on four issues. Number one was the issue of macroeconomic stabilization. First, the issue of the budget deficit. With African economies, and any other economy for that matter, the budget deficit is not fighting. I think sometimes it's actually good to have a budget deficit, particularly with the social obligation that Zimbabwe has. But it's how you finance that budget deficit which makes the difference. If you finance your deficit the way we were doing, monetizing it, printing money, I see the Americans and the British have got a new name for it, a nice name for it, they call quantitative easing. That can't work in Africa. But all you're doing is you're just generating paper, you're just generating inflation. So one of the things that I say, and I actually coined it, he might be vice president, but we eat what we kill. We live within our means. So the issue of cash budgeting was at the core of the macroeconomic stability. The second thing which was at the epicenter of our recovery was the issue of the restoration of positive rates of interest. For over 10 years, the government of Zimbabwe was borrowing through treasury bills and issuing various in paper, but at artificial prices, they were forcing the interest rates to be very low. So for over 10 years, over 12 years, we had negative rates of interest to sustain an artificial deficit. So we liberalized the interest rates. Of course, there were downside disadvantages. And the downside disadvantages was that you actually had the bank selling money at 35% US dollar. Can you imagine 35% on the US dollar to 40% on the US dollar? Something that we are now trying to battle to deal with at the present moment. The third thing, of course, was the issue of the restoration of the financial services sector. We reopened the Zimbabwe Stock Exchange on the 19th of February 2009, after it had been closed on the 19th of November 2008. And we also signed a lot of agreements that would kickstart the financial services sector. For instance, the new agreement on the real transfer growth system, RTGS, a new national payment system, and the restoration of SimSwitch. SimSwitch is a platform interbank connectivity. So that was on macroeconomic stability. The second thing was on supply side reform. As I said before, capacity utilization is sunk to as little as 2 to 10%. So the target of STEP was a capacity utilization of at least 60% by year end. And what we did was we removed all kinds of controls that were on the economy. There were price controls, and some of you will remember that our business people were put in prison in 2006. The first time that I've learned that you fight inflation by genomics, putting business people in prison. So we removed all kinds of controls. One of the most important controls that we removed was a double taxation of our exporters. There was something called export surrender requirements, where all exporters were obliged to surrender between 7% to 15%, so to 20% of their export earnings. So we removed that, and that actually really helped. We also spoke to banks about lines of credit, and some banks actually offered lines of credit. In fact, the financial service sector really helped us in 2009, from a position where after dollarization there is zero assets. They were only left with buildings. Because our dollarization was artificial dollarization, the government did not actually officially buy the old stock of Zimbabwean dollars. It was fake. So people lost their balances. People lost their Zimbabwean dollar balances. Some of us actually know, we have sympathy with a lot of the people who lost their balance, but people were burning money, what Zimbabweans call burning money. Zimbabweans know what I'm talking about. In other words, engaging in criminal activities to get those balances, rent activities. So we didn't actually do formal dollarization. So bank assets as of January 2009, when we dollarized, were a mere $259 million. But by the end of the year, they've risen to $1.2 billion. And as I speak to you right now, they're actually $4.2 billion dollars. And that's remarkable. They brought in money externally, and I want to acknowledge that. Banks also played a role in financing our current account deficit. As I speak to you now, our imports are about $7 billion, and our exports are about $3 billion. So there's a ratio of 3:1 between our imports and our exports. So we are running a very dangerous current account. Some of you have been asking me, when are you returning the Zimbabwean dollar? Surely you can't retain the Zimbabwean dollar when you don't have the economy to sustain that. Your local currency is a relationship between your imports and your exports. If you put this skewed deficit in your current account, in your balance of payment position, in your capital account, you don't have the economy to sustain your currency. And the question you might ask is, we have been supporting this deficit, this current account deficit of 3:1. Certainly it's not the cabinet. Some of the diaspora, certainly you've been playing your part as well with remittances, averaging $350 million a year, but also to the banking sector. We've actually been bringing in resources offshore. The third component of our step was the social services. We created what we call this specially targeted vulnerable sectors. We put in $25 million, which is not a lot of money, but in 2009, it was a lot of money in Zimbabwe. So we targeted people that were living with HIV AIDS, we targeted widows and widowers, we targeted child-run households. We've got many households that are run by children, 12-year-olds, 15-year-olds. And then we targeted female-run households, of which they are playing. And that money went a long way. On hospitals, we had what we called a specially targeted program for hospitals. What we do, because we didn't have a lot of money, we target one hospital. We started with the other hospital. We gave it $2 million. Then we went to Mpilo Hospital. And that $2 million, for instance, would buy new sheets, new beds, crematorium, mortuary, and so forth. And I remember in November 2009 watching this beautiful hospital on ETV. ETV is a South African station. And then I was shocked to actually know that it was a Harare hospital. And I was very pleased by that. I visited a Harare hospital in 2008. And this is the true story. The lift was not working. The lift was not working. Now the mortuary is on the fourth floor of the lift. So nurses and hospital staff would get tired of carrying corpses. So they would just throw the bodies from the lift. So if your relative died of tuberculosis, you would suddenly hear the sky and you say, but did my relative have a road traffic accident in the mortuary? But this would disinfect my lift. It was happening. So we did that in 2009. So the first lesson I think the importance of the plan. The fourth issue on state peace, and I just complete, is of course monetizing the peace process, putting money into the peace process, putting money into the reform agenda, in particular the constitution making process, in particular some of the commissions that we have created. So those were the four pillars of STEP. I think the results have been there for everyone to see, and I will not talk a lot about that. But I think for me, the lessons of the last 4 years are as follows. Number one, there is no substitute for peace. There is no substitute for peace and stability. Political peace is a precondition to economic development. So whatever you do, the issue of peace is important. The issue of dialogue is important. We are still in a very difficult position. The two main political parties are still in an extremely difficult position, ZANU-PF and MDC. But the fact that the Prime Minister and the President can sit every Monday afternoon religiously, have pancakes, and see, use the cups that were meant for the Queen when she came for Chogum in 1990. This is true, the cups were bought for and President Mugabe is very proud of his t-shirt. I think those pancakes are important. Dialogue in a nation is extremely important. And I have absolute doubt that it has mitigated some of the excesses that could have taken place, particularly in a very difficult, contested environment. The second thing is the importance of having a plan. A plan signifies a common vision, and I will speak about this later on. And then our experience in the Ministry of Finance is that you have to be strong and you have to have a thick skin. They will come at you, they will throw arrows, they will. And everyone is an economist. You know, when things fail, it's like football. I'm a supporter of a stupid football team called Arsenal Football Club. with a stupid French coach that we must fire. So we've all become coaches. You must do this, you must do this. When the team is winning, we don't say that. Ferguson, I'm sure, doesn't hear a lot of that. But Man City, Manchester City getting knocked out of Europe, maybe you're getting a few of those tips. So when the team is underperforming, everyone becomes a coach. The same applies to an economy. Everyone is a finance minister. So you get a lot of brickbats being thrown at you. And I think it's important to know what is good for the people of Zimbabwe. and to stick to what you believe. So we have been very thick-skinned in the last 4 years. But there are certain structural things which I would like to talk about. I think the first thing which is corrosive to countries, the states that I call states in permanent crisis, is the existence of what I call predatory politics. Predatory politics is cyclical politics. Predatory politics is based on the subordination of the economy and the capacity of people to reproduce themselves to politics. And unfortunately, the Zimbabwean economy is one that is totally subordinated to politics. Everything we do is marinated in politics, is arrested by politics. And to deal with these things is actually important, not just to deal with the issues of peace and nation building, but also the creation of institutions, state institutions that are inclusive, starting with the constitution. The constitution is so critical and fundamental. The constitution is an agreement between citizens on one they want to be governed. The constitution underpins the restoration of the social contract. So it's so important in dominated social formations, in states that are in permanent crisis, to actually have a constitution. And not just have constitution, but also constitutionalism. Because there are countries, I think virtually almost every African country has got a constitution. But those constitutions don't have constitutionalism. What do I mean by not having constitutionalism? You have leaders that stay in power for 14 years and 16 years, or 32 years.